All right, so just for the sake of some level of completeness of what is written on the whiteboard, I just noticed that I discussed this example and I wrote if this is different than zero, and in what way? So in this case, actually the Fisher information is infinite in this case. You can think how to prove it, certainly for, you know, if this was one nuance, you know that that should be the case, but yeah. Okay, so what I want to do now is to discuss in a more complete manner how neural correlations affect discriminability. So we will think about Fisher information or, you know, small situations where we need to do discriminations between nearby stimuli. It's a more specific question than, you know, just estimation in general. And we're going to explore this question under some additional assumptions, which I will lay out now. And some assumptions and some simplifications. Our model will be the following. We have a neural population. So, we have a neural population, and the responses are given by some tuning curves, and we have some pairwise correlations, some general pairwise correlations. I'll explain in a moment in more detail what I mean. So, for simplicity, we're thinking of the responses as continuous, not number, integer numbers. The mean response condition on theta, the mean responses are fi, and then the noise, so ri is going to be, you know, the mean of ri is going to be fi of theta plus delta Ri, and conditioned on theta, delta Ri, delta Rj, minus delta Ri, delta Rj is equal to Cij. But in fact, I'm going to assume now that also the structure of these pairwise correlations is independent of theta. So the mean response depends on theta, but the variability around it, the structure of the correlations, does not depend on theta. So this is what we can say about delta Ri, delta Rj. And moreover, for simplicity, we will assume Gaussian statistics of the variability. So this means that if I want to ask what is the probability distribution of R given theta, it's a multidimensional Gaussian. How do we write a multidimensional Gaussian? Here I need some matrix with indices ij. I didn't write it yet. Okay, so what is this matrix? C to the minus 1, good. So this is the ijth element of the inverse of the correlation matrix. How do I know? And before I ask how do I know, there's one more thing missing, which is the normalization. We can write explicitly what it is, but I don't want to do it, so I just write this. How do I know that this is the matrix that should come up here? Because I know that for a multidimensional Gaussian of this form, the covariance matrix is the inverse of the matrix that appears here. Right? So if I say that that the covariance matrix has to be Cij, then what I need to have here is the inverse of this matrix. All right. And maybe I will put this now over there. Is this okay? And I will continue. Okay, good. I know that it's somewhere around. And we're going to discuss discrimination. Theta 1 versus theta 2. So maybe I will write this. I will write this here. So we're discussing a discrimination problem. Theta 1 versus theta 2. And therefore, for simplicity, to simplify our notation, we will denote Fi of theta 1 as Fi minus, and Fi of theta 2 is Fi plus. And finally, we're not going to discuss discrimination of an ideal discriminator or just a very general discriminator. We're only going to consider linear discriminators. So this, of course, is a limitation of our discussion, but we will see what we can learn about how correlations affect the performance of a linear discriminator. So, it will be based on, so it will be, you know, a theta function, or it will be the sign. The discriminator will spit out an answer which is plus or minus one. And it will be the sign of some function of the responses. Well, this function is a linear function of the observation. So L of R is sum over Wi Ri. And I might put here a W to remind myself that this is dependent. These are parameters of the discriminator, and it depends on these parameters. Okay, so now... yeah, there could be a B. Yeah. Let me, for convenience, in my notation, I will put the B here. Okay? Just because this is how I wrote things. I defined L like this. All right. So what I would like to do now is to... Well, you know, we discussed already discriminators several times. Remember that for discriminators, it's quite clear what we want to do. We want to minimize the probability of error. So we want to set... the weight such that we will minimize the error, and then we want to ask what is the probability of error. And I claim that under the assumptions that I laid out here, this is a fairly simple problem. Can you tell me why? What can we say about L? For, you know, we are considering now just two cases. The stimulus can be either theta 1 or theta 2. And in each one of them, in each one of these cases, how is L distributed? The R's, yes, the R's have the mean which is defined by this, and it's fixed for a given theta. And then the where did I write it? Yeah, it's Gaussian, it's written here. So that's right. Why is it Gaussian? Because a linear combination of Gaussian variables is always a so, right? So if you have a group of variables, the I, which are mutually Gaussian or normal distributed, any linear combination of them is a Gaussian. So that means that P of L given theta 1 and P of L given theta 2 L is just a number, so it's a one-dimensional normal distribution. Each one of them is a one-dimensional normal distribution. They will not have necessarily the same mean, maybe also not the same variance. So let's draw this. In general, I know that condition on theta, so what I'm writing here is P of L, and this is theta. This is L, the value of L, and this is a probability to get that value. And there's a certain probability if theta is equal to theta 1, and there's another probability if theta is equal to theta 2. In any case, the distribution will be normal. So P of L given theta 1 might look like this, right? And P of L given theta 2 will also be a normal variable. And so L, remember, I decided to define it just as the linear combination of the R, and I still have the freedom to choose this B. How should I choose it? Suppose that I decided on some particular set of weights. What should I choose B to be? Okay, what choice of B will minimize my error? This intersection, right? Because I would want to choose the theta for which L is more likely. So I collapsed all my data, all my R's into one number, this L. And now, if I want to decide, I see the observation. All I know is L now. This is all I get from I use about the R. I want to decide: am I choosing theta 2 or theta 1? I would choose the one for which L is more likely. So therefore this is the best, this is the going to be the B. And now what the game is that by playing with the W's, I can change the means of this Gaussian, and I can change the mean of this Gaussian, and also the variance will change. And the question is, what is the choice of the weights that will minimize the probability of error, which is the weight of this area plus this area. So in order to calculate this, I need the means, because these are normal variables, they are fully characterized by the means and the variances. So I need the means and the variances. What is the mean of this? Yes. For example, if all the W's are zero, then the variance is zero. But that's not a good choice, because then also the means are the same. Right? If all the W's are zero, then we just always get zero, L is just equal to zero, and we can't discriminate based on L. Okay, so but what is the mean? What is the mean, of L given theta 1? Let's call that mu 1.
Mu
Okay, so what is it? Yes, very good. So, mu 1 is the mean of L given theta 1. It's just sum over I, W I, F, what I called F minus, right? I. Right, it's Fi of theta 1. And mu 2 is equal to sum over I, Wi, Fi plus. And now I need the variance. So in principle there are two or standard deviations. Each one of these Gaussians has a standard deviation. Is it, do I need to calculate both? Okay, right. So the variances, right. So the variances are going to be the same because once I subtract the mean, the variability has the same structure. You know, Cij does not depend on theta in our model. It could, but it, we modeled it as independent of theta. So therefore, these two standard deviations will be the same, and we just need to calculate them. So, okay, so we need to calculate them. What does that mean? We need to calculate the variance of this quantity. So this is sum over I and j, wi, wj, ri, rj. Or let's even write it in more detail. So I will write it as the average of L square given theta minus L square. Or I can also write it as so let's do it for theta 1, but it doesn't matter. Okay? And okay, so I could do the theta 1. I write just theta, it doesn't matter, it's the same for any theta. So I can also write it as L minus L average square. This is just the other way to write the variance. And what does that mean? So that means that I need to calculate the mean of sum over I, Wi, Ri, minus sum over I, let me do it like this, minus theta, minus Fi. Well, Fi is a response for theta, right? And this is squared. Okay, so when I have a square of a sum, I can write it as a sum over two indices, I and j. So, and Wi's are just fixed, they're numbers, so I can take them out of the average. So this will be sum over I and j, Wi, Wj, and average over Ri minus Fi, Rj minus Fj. But this, by definition, is what we call Cij. So this is sum over I and j, Wi, Wj, Cij. So this is the variance here. And now, now since I know both the mean of each one of these Gaussians and the standard deviation, I can write down what is the probability of error. The probability of error is equal to this area. More precisely, it's equal to half. Let's imagine that the stimuli appear in identical probabilities. It's half this area, which is the probability of error if the stimulus is theta 1 plus half this area, but these two areas are the same because the variances of these two Gaussians are the same. So this area is the same as this, so I can just write the probability of error as this area. In other words, P error, the probability of error, because there's a probability, it's the more correct way to write it is the probability that the stimulus is theta 1 times the probability of error if the stimulus is theta 1. The probability of theta, stimulus is theta 1 is half. So it's half times this area plus half times this area. But because these two areas are the same, it's also just this area. Okay? So, P error, what is it? It's an integral from this point. This point is the average of mu 1 and mu 2, so it's mu 1 plus mu 2 over 2 up to infinity, and this Gaussian. So this Gaussian is 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma square exponent of minus x minus mu 1 square divided by 2 sigma square, and the integral again is dx. So it's, I'm just writing the integral of this function from here up to infinity. And you know, this is an error function essentially. It's an error function, so if we just plug, do the correct manipulation, we end up with the result that this is half the complementary error function of d prime over 2 square root of 2, and I just want to write it with the same notation that we used previously for discriminators. And this d prime, okay, this d prime, I will write. No, because this is the average of these two.
Oh, okay.
Right? It's the average of these two. Hmm? It's the B. So, yes. It's this B that appears here. Remember that the B is another parameter, but we realize by looking at this plot that the best way to choose it is at this point. So given if I choose... then I think it's not necessarily it's the point of intersection.
Yes.
So if the again, if the variances, if this variance and this variance were not the same, then the point of intersection would not necessarily be it would not be at the middle between the two averages. But in this case, it is because this sigma is the same as this sigma. All right. So, but I need to write what is d prime, otherwise I didn't write anything here. Anything meaningful. So this d prime comes out of the manipulation of the integral, expressing it as an error function, and d prime square, the discriminability, and it turns out to be equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 square over sigma square. This is just the general conclusion from, you know, the parameters that appear here. Mu 2 minus... this requires a bit of work. But I will skip it. You will do it as an exercise. And let me write down what this means. So, since our answer, before I continue, let's just see that this makes sense. There could have been some prefactor here, numerical prefactor, but it's obvious that the probability of error will depend on the ratio between the difference between the means and the standard deviation, right? So it's clear, it's just by the nature of the problem, looking at this plot, it's obvious that our answer here should be some function of the ratio mu 2 minus mu 1 divided by sigma. And the particular function is the function that we found here. All right, so because it depends on mu2 minus mu1, and mu1 and mu2 are these things that depend on Fi minus and Fi plus, in this way, it's convenient to define Gi as Fi plus minus Fi minus. And then, once I do that, I can write the numerator here as sum over I Gi Wi, and this is squared, divided by sigma squared, which is sum over I and J, Wi, Wj, Cij. And if I want to use vector notation or vector and matrix notation, this is the vector G transpose W multiplied with inner product with W squared, and here it's W transpose CW. So what we found here now is the probability of error for a particular choice of these weights after we already optimized the B. The B we chose like this, but this is still a function of W. We want to find the W that maximizes the discriminability. You see that maximizing the discriminability is making these two responses as far apart from each other relative to the variability, relative to the standard deviation. Okay, so we need to find the optimal weight. And for that, we will take the derivative of d prime squared with respect to wi and require that that is zero. Okay, so we need to find the weights that minimize this ratio. So, one thing to note before we continue, which is always a useful thing to remember, is that when we want to minimize a ratio of two expressions, we can use the fact that t to the x of some expression which is a numerator divided by a denominator, the fact that this is zero, if you want that to be zero, what does that mean? It means that n prime divided by d minus n d prime divided by d squared is zero. And this is the same as saying that n prime over n is the same as d prime over d. So whenever you need to optimize, to minimize the ratio, it's convenient to write it in this way. That you want the derivative of the numerator divided by itself to be the same as the derivative of the denominator divided by itself. I want to maximize it. But it's... Yeah, I want to maximize it. Derivative is zero. That's absolutely right. I want to maximize it, yes. The minimum is obvious. It's you choose all the weights to be zero and you minimize it. But if we don't want to minimize it. So this is how I will write it. I will write this condition by writing the derivative of this divided by itself and the derivative of this divided by itself. Okay, so what is the derivative of this with respect to Wi? I want to take the derivative of this with respect to the ith weight. Come on, this is David. What? Okay, it's a derivative. How do we take the derivative? 2, okay, thank you. Now what? G transpose W times the inner derivative. What is the derivative of this thing with respect to Wi? It's G, which G? G-I. G-I. So this is a derivative of the numerator with respect to WI, and I divide by the numerator. And this needs to be the derivative of the denominator divided by itself. Okay, what is this? What is the derivative of this, also written here, with respect to WI? Okay, summary J, C, I, J, W, J, and this is almost correct. What is missing?
Twice,
because we took the explicitly like the derivative with respect to this, to the case where WI appears here, but it can also appear here. So those are two. So this is 2 divided by W transpose CW. And you see that the 2 here and the 2 here are cancel out, factor out. And therefore, okay, this looks a bit complicated, but it's much more simple than what it looks like. I will explain in a moment. So let me just write it down again here without the 2. G transpose W divided by, 1 over G transpose W. Right? Because we had this cancels with 1 power here multiplied by GI is equal to 1 over W transpose CW. Multiplied by sum over j, cij, wj. Okay, so you see here that what we get, this is a number that does not depend on the index I. This also is a number that does not depend on the index I, right? So you see here that what we got is that gi is proportional to sum over j, cij, wj. And there's some proportionality constant, which is the same for all the i's. What is the proportionality constant? Okay, so you can do the exercise and plug this expression in here to find the proportionality constant, and you'll see that you'll get some equation like 1 equal to 1. It's an equation that will not tell you what is the proportionality constant. So suppose that you would write GI is A, alpha, times this thing. You want to find alpha. Plug this back here, you will find that the equation doesn't tell you what is alpha. Does that make sense? What happens to our discriminator if we multiply all the weights by a constant?
Doesn't care,
right? Because in the end we do a thresholding. We already set the threshold to be the optimal one, so it will scale. The threshold will scale, of course, if you multiply all the weights by a constant, the B that we wrote, will optimal B will scale by that constant. But then the discriminator will do the same thing, right? We're checking whether this linear combination is larger or smaller than zero. It doesn't matter if you multiply it by a constant. So by definition of the problem, it should be obvious for us from the start that weights are going to be defined, the optimal weights are going to be defined up to a multiplicative constant. And you can see this also from this equation. Because if there is some solution to this equation and you multiply the weight by a constant, then here the left-hand side, we are dividing by that constant. On the right hand side also, here it appears quadratically, but here it appears in the numerator linearly. So the way it's actually, we can choose the GI to be some constant alpha, and we can choose it, any alpha that we choose will do just as well, doesn't matter. Okay? So we'll just choose it to be 1. So our conclusion is that the optimal weights are proportional to C times. Okay, so now finally we want the weights. So the equation that you see here is that the vector G is proportional to the matrix C multiplied by W. And therefore, and these are the optimal weights. So the optimal weights are proportional to the inverse of the matrix C multiplied by the vector G. And what is the D prime for the optimal weights? We need to take now these weights and plug them in this expression. So, what will we get? So, we have here G transpose multiplied by C minus 1 G, and all this is squared, divided by, we need to take the transpose of this. This is G transpose times C minus 1. Now, I do not write C minus 1 transpose because C is a symmetric matrix, so its transpose is the same as itself. And then there's a C. And then there's W again, which is C minus 1 G. And so you see that we can cancel out one of these combinations of C and C minus 1, either this one or this one, and we'll end up with the same expression as what we have here squared. We'll end up with G transpose C minus 1 G. So this is what we found now is that the optimal D prime square is G transpose C minus 1 G. Some obvious things to note, if all the G's are zero, if the response does not depend on the stimulus, then the D prime will be zero. We will have no discriminability. I think that this is maybe a good time to take a break. Yeah, so let's take a break now and then we'll consider some examples.
you mean? Again.
What do you mean?
Last time. I have. Wait. Where should. Ah, wait, wait. I have this document for the second partner. One moment.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to copy now our results. We did, you know, we did some mathematical calculations. We now have an answer. The answer is that the optimal weights are C minus 1 G. And I'm proportional to, because you can choose any, multiply this by any constant, doesn't matter. And the optimal D prime is G transpose C minus 1 G. So after all the dust has settled, this is what we are left with, and now we want to explore this result in some, I want to explore this result in some examples. So let's start. So I'm going to discuss some examples. The first example will be n identical uncorrelated neurons. So by identical I mean that the GIs, you know, remember this was defined as Fi plus and minus Fi minus. By identical I mean that this does not depend on I. It's the same for all the neurons. And by uncorrelated, I mean that Cij is equal to some constant times delta ij. Right? This matrix, the matrix C, has a structure A times unity matrix. Okay, what will the weights look like, the optimal weights look like? Yeah, but we can multiply it by any constant. So it's just a vector of where all the elements are the same. Okay, this makes sense. What we are allowed to do in our discrimination is add up all the activities of all the neurons with some weights. All the neurons are the same, so why would we choose different weights for different neurons? So W optimal I is just some W. And the D prime optimal square it's this expression. So it's G, you know, this matrix is diagonal and the elements are 1 over A. So what are we going to get? What is the D prime optimal squared? Okay, maybe, but maybe not.
Times
the number of neurons, that's right. Because we have a contribution from each, you know, we do the sandwich of this, we have 1 over 8 times unity matrix, sandwich which with the vector G, we have each contribution from each one of the diagonal elements. Okay, does this make sense? First of all, you know, the discriminability that we got is linear in the number of neurons. We have neurons with independent noise. So this should make sense to you. And in fact, it's really the discriminability that we should expect based on the Fisher information. Because we assume that the stimuli are Gaussian, that the responses are Gaussian, we are saturating the K-Meral bound, and this is really what we expect based on the Fisher information, which is linear in the number of neurons. All right. And we can do this with this linear discriminator in this case. All right. Now let's consider n identical correlated neurons. Now, I'm not going to, when I say correlated, I want to consider now a model where they can be partially correlated. So I will use a model for the correlation matrix which has a parameter in it, which can we can vary between completely uncorrelated to completely correlated. So our GIs are still going to be the same for all the neurons. This is what I mean by identical neurons. But now, for the matrix CIJ, let's consider the following form. So let's consider a matrix which has on its diagonal elements the same as before. A, okay? So the variance of the variance of the noise in each neuron is still the same as in the case of that we considered previously, but now we will also imagine that there are off-diagonal elements. And they're all the same. Meaning that, you know, the covariance between any two neurons is the same. If they're not the same neurons, any two neurons have the same covariance, and it's some number. So if I want to write this mathematically, I can write this as A times delta IJ. This will be, you know, this will take care of the diagonal elements, and then there's some other value for the non-diagonal elements, which is A times alpha, so I can write here alpha times 1 minus delta IJ. So for the non-diagonal elements, this will be 1, for the non-diagonal elements, this will be 1, and so we will, and this will be 0, so we'll get alpha A. For the diagonal elements, this will be 1, and this will be 0, so we'll get A. Okay, so just in what this means is that when alpha goes to 0, we're going back to the uncorrelated case. When alpha equals to 1, what happens? Right, so it's actually, when alpha equals to 1, the covariance between any two neurons is the same as the variance, and this is really, you can think about it more. This is can only be the case if all the neurons, the responses of all the neurons are identical on a trial-by-trial basis. The noise is the same as on the neurons. So alpha equals 1 is fully correlated. And I would just want to comment that we cannot make alpha larger than 1. Right, so what happens if you try to make alpha larger than 1 is that you find that this matrix is no longer positive definite. And the covariance matrix has to be positive definite. So that you cannot devise, you know, think of a probability distribution of n observations that have a covariance matrix of this form where alpha is larger than 1. It will never happen.
It makes sense, right? Because it can be more correlated than...
Right, exactly. It makes sense. Alpha can also be negative, but also there's a limit for how much negative it could be. Actually, I'm not sure. I think it could be negative. In any case, now what do we need to do? So we need to find... So first of all, what about the weights? What can we say about the optimal weights? So remember, the vector of G is still a vector which has the same element in each row.
So every
neuron is the same in the sense that it's, you know, it's correlated with itself with some variance, correlated with the other ones, which all the other ones with some other ones. There's no difference between the weights, and therefore, you know, the matrix C minus 1 that enters here will be a matrix that has the same value, the same sum of elements on each row. So that's what matters here. So the W opt is still going to be some W. It's not going to depend I. It's going to be independent of I. If you want to calculate the discriminability, we now need to invert this matrix. Okay, how can we invert this matrix? So what I'd like you to think about for a moment is how, what could be the structure of the inverse matrix of this matrix? Okay, it's going to be symmetric. What else can we say about it? Of course it will depend, no, okay. Of course the elements will depend on A and on alpha, but about the structure, what kind of structure can this, can the inverse matrix? what, I mean, in terms of, you know, this matrix has the structure that it has the same value on all elements of the diagonal, and then the same value on all other elements. What do you because there's no, this means that any pair of neurons, the relationship between them is exactly the same, we can expect the same thing for the neurons, I'm saying neurons, but any pair of indices, the elements are the same, we can expect the same structure for the inverse matrix. So we can guess, you know, we can actually guess or realize that the structure of this matrix is going to be the same. So let's just call it let's parameterize a matrix of this form in the same way as here, but we need to find B and beta. And now we just, how do we find B and beta? We need to multiply this matrix by this matrix and make sure that we get a unity matrix. We have two parameters. And obviously the answer, we'll have a certain answer on the diagonal element, and we have another answer on the non-diagonal element. So that will give us two equations. We have two equations, two parameters, and therefore we will be able to find B and beta. Okay? So I'm not going to do it. I'm going to write down the answer. Well, it's not so simple. It's okay, you know what? Let's just write the equations. So C minus 1 C is equal to the unity matrix I on the diagonal elements. It means that A B plus N minus 1. I'm using small N. No, I'm using large N. N minus 1. A alpha, yeah, that's right. A, B, A, alpha, beta is equal to 1, right? Because that's on the diagonal element. And on the non-diagonal elements, we can take any one of them. So, alpha, okay, so we have A, alpha, say let's take this row multiplied by this column. So, we have A times B, beta. This will be what we get from this times this, and then the rest. And then this is also special, because here we will get A times. We're taking this row. So we get A alpha times B, and then on the rest of the elements, which are n minus two of them. We will get A, B, alpha, beta. And this needs to be 0, because these are the off-diagonal elements. So the off-diagonal elements of the unity matrix are 0. So these are the two equations that we need to solve. And I think it's correct, but I didn't do it carefully at home before. It's not written on my notebook, so you should check. But I can write down the solution. I have written here the solution. So when you solve it, what you find is that B is equal to the following expression. I know that sometimes my alpha and my 2 are similar, so I tried here to make them different, but elsewhere you should be checking carefully what I write. So this is alpha, 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 there's a 2 here. And beta ends up being minus alpha divided by n alpha plus 1 minus 2 alpha. Okay, not a very illuminating expression, but we can now use it. So you know, d prime square the optimal d prime square is g, you know, it's basically g square times a vector of 1 times this matrix c minus 1 times a vector of 1, right? I mean, this was g g g g g g g g g g. I took the g out here, so it's 1 times a vector of 1 times this matrix. So what is this thing? What is this what does this yield, this, when we multiply this vector by this matrix by this vector? No, but in general, for any matrix, when you multiply from both sides by the vectors of 1, what do you get? Somewhat? Yeah, it's just the sum of all the elements in the matrix, right? So this will give us, this will be g squared times, we have n elements which are beta, which are b, and then we have all the non-diagonal elements, which are n times n minus 1 over 2. That's the number of these elements. And in these elements, the entry is b times beta. And we have expressions for b and beta. So, I will continue here. I think it's no half. There's no half. I think you're right. No, there's no half. Yeah, it's n squared minus n. It's n times n minus 1. Thank you. Yes, okay. So, we have g squared times b times n. That appears in all the expressions. Times 1 plus n minus 1 times beta. Right? Yeah, n minus 1 times beta, the b I took out. Now we just need to plug in these expressions. And so here I will skip some additional steps and I will tell you the answer. So the answer ends up being not so terribly ugly. Okay, this is really the answer that we're interested in. Okay, so let's check some limiting cases. Alpha equals 0 is the case that we did it. This was alpha equals 0 is example 1, uncorrelated neurons, right? So we better get the same answer, and we do. Alpha, when we plug in alpha equals 0, we get g squared n over a, so that matches what we know. What I want to discuss now is what happens when alpha is between 1 and 0. And what I want to consider is what happens now when we increase n and make n very large. So I claim that whenever alpha is non-zero, something happens here which is qualitatively different from this case. In this case, the discriminability continues to increase indefinitely with n, right? We can make the discriminability as large as we want by increasing n. once alpha is non-zero, this is no longer the case. This expression will increase first with n, but it will saturate. When n goes to infinity, the discriminability becomes g squared over a alpha. So if we would plot it as a function of n,
is it common to address that discriminability of d prime squared, or
that's a good question. No, I think d prime is a discriminability, but I'm just it's just that saying each time the square discriminability. So if we look at the d prime squared opt as a function of n, then it will increase and then saturate. And this value is what we calculated here. It doesn't look really like this, it looks more like, something like this. Okay. We'll saturate. So, once we have even a minuscule amount of correlation between the neurons, we no longer have this property that we can improve our discriminability indefinitely in this example. We saturate it, so at some point adding more neurons to a population like this will not be helpful for the discriminability, but this saturated value is larger the smaller the correlation. Okay, the smaller the correlation, this value will be larger, and vice versa. If we take the limit where alpha is equal to, if we take the case of alpha equals to 1, in fact, in that case, we immediately get to the saturated value. You see that if alpha equals to 1, we have here n minus 1 plus 1. So this is just 1. So we immediately, regardless of the number of neurons, we get that d prime square is equal to g square over a. Does this make sense? Regardless of n. Does this make sense? Yeah, all the neurons are identical. They're producing the same output. They're fully correlated. They're producing the same output in each trial, so it doesn't matter how many neurons we have. All right? Okay, so in this example, having correlations is detrimental. The best situation is to have alpha equals 0, and this is a monotonic function of alpha. The smaller alpha, the better. And furthermore, any minuscule amount of correlation means that we cannot improve the discriminability indefinitely by adding more neurons. Now let's look at a third example. So actually, I need to think if it's possible to have a negative alpha. Maybe it's not possible in this example. The intuition why I think it's probably not possible is that if neurons A and B are anticorrelated, B and C are anticorrelated, then you'd expect A and C to be correlated. So it doesn't make sense to me that you can have. So my guess is that if you take the matrix that I wrote and make alpha negative, immediately you will get. See that the matrix is not positive definite. I think this is what will happen. So we cannot have alpha negative, I think. I didn't think about it carefully enough. Okay, so 3. This is our third example. And I'm kind of following the logic of the example that I started with when I started this discussion. So now let's imagine we have two populations with opposing responses. to population with exposing responses. So that means that the GI are equal to Fi, which is the Fi plus minus Fi minus. Half of the neurons increase the response, you know, for theta 2 versus theta 1. And half of them decrease the response. Okay? But still the noise is the same, has the same structure as before. So Cij, it will be the matrix that we discussed, A times delta ij plus 1 minus delta ij alpha. So again, we have, you know, the vector G has the structure of G times 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 up to half, and then the other half is minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. Okay, let's start, and I want to consider here both the, well, how will the optimal weights look like, and how will the discriminability look like. So, what about the weights? So the optimal weights are, we will see. But I would like you to remember that I started out the discussion with neurons that are fully that the noise is fully correlated. It's got a case of two neurons that are, where the noise is fully correlated. So this would be the case where alpha is equal to 1, and one of them increases response and the other decreases response. Or, you know, the responses were different. And then I argued that you can have infinite discriminability. So maybe it does matter. Right, because you could take and the logic is that you can take the difference between the activity if the neurons are fully correlated. So in the previous case, if the neurons were fully correlated, in this case, if the neurons are fully correlated, I can take, say, the difference between the activity of this neuron and this neuron, and if they're fully correlated, I remove the noise, and we'll get a signal that is telling me something about the stimulus. This didn't work in the previous case because the responses of other neurons were the same. So if I take the difference, I don't get anything informative. So let's see what happens. Okay, so first of all, what are the optimal weights? I need to take this vector and multiply it by the inverse of this matrix. The inverse of this matrix multiplied by this vector. What kind of vector will I get? Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. So it will be a vector. Remember that the prefactor here is completely arbitrary anyway. So it will be this vector. Which kind of makes sense, right? You have these neurons that are increasing the response. These neurons are decreasing the response. So if I want to come up with the best linear estimator, I will weigh them with opposite weights. Those that increase and those that decrease, I will sum all these. All the first group of groups, then these I will sum with an opposite sign. Now, what can we say about the discriminability? So, the discriminability is, d prime square optimal is now g squared times the vector, you know, 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, times the matrix C minus 1, times the vector 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So Now, the matrix C minus 1, we know how it looks like, right? It's, we wrote it. It's this matrix with the B and the beta.
So, you also knew which is YW looks like that? Because, I mean, C minus 1 in when you multiply it by something that's 1, 1, 1, and then minus 1, then, you, I mean, it does...
So, it all that matters is... I claim that you will get the same result. So, you take C minus 1 and multiply it by this vector. My claim is that you'll get the same result in the n min- in the first n over 2 entries. So you take the first row of C minus 1 and multiply it by this vector. You take the second row and multiply it by this vector. You take
oh,
the third row.
The
question is whether the diagonal ends up being on this part or on this part. That's the only thing that matters. Okay? No, the C is the same matrix as before. It's an n by n matrix, but it's a circulant matrix. It's a matrix that has the same each row is the same up to a right. It's a diagonal matrix also. Remember, just to think about how it looks like, and then. It's not maybe it might be big, a little bigger. It might be much bigger. You can write it down. You can work it out if you want. Write down exactly what you will get, and you will see that that's the case. So, I will not do it explicitly right now. So, all right. So look, what we need to calculate now is this vector multiplied by c minus 1 times this vector. So how can we approach this task? We can take the matrix C, which is n by n, C minus 1, is an n by n matrix, it's not so good. Okay, this is an n by n matrix, and I can divide it into four submatrices. This one, this one, this one, and this one. Four n by 2 by n by 2 submatrices. And in fact, what you get in this summation is from terms that involve one of these elements and one of these elements, you get the sum of all the elements in this one. From the terms that involve one of these elements and one of these elements, you will also get the sum of all these elements times minus 1 times minus 1, but minus 1 squared is 1. So you will get the sum of all these elements. But you will also get elements from here and here, and these will come with a minus sign, because if this will come from the cases where you take an element from here and elements from here. This will give you the sum of all these elements with a minus sign. And then if you take an element from here and an element from here, you'll get the sum of all these with a minus sign. But this is a symmetric matrix, so this is just the sum of these elements is the sum of these elements. And also because of the structure, the sum of these elements is the sum of these elements. So we'll get twice the sum of all these elements, or if you want the sum of these elements and the sum of these elements, minus twice the sum of all these elements. So minus these, minus these. Okay, so we know how the matrix, because we know how the matrix C minus 1 looks like, we just can write down what it is. So let's do that. The matrix C minus 1, I remind you, has a structure B times 1 beta, beta, beta. Right? It's 1, then betas everywhere else. Okay, so d prime opt square okay, we need to sum first all these elements, but we'll get the same result from here, so I will write a 2, and then it's actually the same expression as what we had before where n is replaced by n over 2. So I need to consult what we had before. It's g square b, and now instead of n, I write n over 2 times 1 plus n over 2 minus 1, previously we had n here, beta. So this is a contribution from this to this part. And then we need the contribution from this part. This we need to do separately. So we have minus, first of all, minus because of these minus on here or here. So, and there are the two because this contribution from this will be the same as from this. And now what is the sum of all the elements in this part? So first of all, the g square, and all the elements in these parts are just b times beta. There's no, these elements are not on the diagonal, so it's b times beta. And how many elements like this do we have?
N divided by 2 square.
N divided by 2 square. Okay, that's what we get. But then, turns out that when you do the math, you get a very simple expression out of all this. You need to plug in now B and beta, that we know we have expressions from them, they're pretty ugly. But everything ends up giving a simple result. You get G squared over times N divided by 1 minus alpha. So this is quite remarkable, because what you see here is that in this case, first of all, regardless of the correlation, the structure of the correlation, regardless of alpha, this is always increasing with n. Of course, if alpha is equal to 0, then we get g squared times n. Does this make sense? Yeah, something here seems to me to be... I think that there's an A missing here. My guess is that there's an A missing here, maybe... Not sure. So let's think about it for a moment.
Why do we need A? Because the information is like how uncorrelated is only determined by alpha. Because A scales like the whole matrix.
Well, but A multiplied also L.
Yeah,
I think it should be one. I think there's an A missing here. The A, see, the A is also here. I'm pretty sure. It's just also a matter of units. Yeah, so I'm pretty sure that there's an A missing, and if I would double check this, the calculation, because I don't have here all the derivation, and I will tell you if there's something else. But the remarkable thing that you see here is that regardless of alpha, again, the discriminability can increase. And in fact, when alpha approaches 1, when the neurons are fully correlated, what happens? It goes to infinity. So even for a finite number of neurons, when alpha goes to 1, the discriminability goes to infinity, and we can expect this based on the discussion, the qualitative discussion that we had before. If the variability is the same in the neurons, we can take differences of neurons, subtract out the noise, and then we get something which is a signal which is completely noiseless, which tells us whether it's theta 1 or theta 2. Okay. I think I will wait for the next. If I start something to discuss I want to discuss some geometrical interpretation of all these results, but it will take us more than a few minutes, so I think I will stop here, but maybe, are there any questions? Okay. So, Thursday, possibly we will have 2 hours of Tirgul, Sneta. Not sure yet, I will let you know. So I will see you either on Thursday or next Tuesday.
Thank you.